make that spot on 1 o'clock. Welcome to the October meeting of the Liverpool City Region Combined Authority. Can we ensure that all phones are turned to silent, and I can remind members when they are presenting to use the microphones so that people in the public galleries can hear. Start, unfortunately, with something of sad news to the Gulf City region. This week marks the sad loss of Sir Bernd Massey, who was one of the country's leading campaigners for disability rights and a celebrated son of Liverpool. He had a profound impact on anyone who met him and leaves a huge gap. I've had the pleasure of working with Sir Bernd over the last few months on developing the Fairness and Social Justice Advisory Board, and therefore can I invite everyone to join me in standing for a minute's silence in memory of Sir Bernd Massey. I think it's a good idea when the chair of any committee asks people to do something that they do it for themselves, so apologies for not turning the microphone to silence. I'll try and do that as I'm going along. Item one is apologies for absence.
I've received apologies from Councillor Brumble, Deputy Mayor Anderson, Jane Kennedy, Councillor Robinson, Councillor O'Neill, Barbara Spicer, and Ian Bentrover.
Are there any further apologies? No, item two is declarations of interest. Are there any interests to declare in members?
I haven't received any, Chair.
No. Item three is the minutes of the meeting of the Combined Authority held on the 15th of September 2017, which are included on pages 1 to 14. But there's a proposed amendment to minute 73, Mersey Rail Update, which is on page 7, fifth paragraph, and it should be as follows. He reported that this was the right solution for Merseyrail, given the nature of the network, which was very different to the northern and southern networks, but similar to the Manchester Metro and Glasgow network. Subject to that one single amendment, can we agree the minutes to be true and correct? Record?
Approved.
Item four is the rail announcements and updates, and this month has been an awful lot happening. I attended the Northern Leaders meeting with the Mayor of Greater Manchester and Council leaders right away from across the North to call on the government to honour its full commitment to transport investment in the North of England. We've already discussed the need to establish a body to provide a coordinated voice on the national and international stage to articulate our common concerns, but also to promote the North of England as an entity. And this body of work, we will ensure works constructively with the government with the aim of securing a fair share of investments in the North to deliver the Northern powerhouse. A few weeks ago, I met with the cross-party leaders of the Cheshire Councils to consider how the two regions can work more closely on areas of mutual benefit. And this was a really positive meeting. We agreed to continue an ongoing dialogue and to share information on strategic proposals that impact either side of the city region boundary. I also attended a summit with David Davis, the Deputy Secretary, and other Northern Metro mayors to discuss how we can ensure our input into the Brexit negotiations is considered. And Janet Beer, He's just come in, Mark Basnett, and I outlined our concerns over the potential differential impact of Brexit on areas like ours. And it was a real positive meeting, and the outcome was that David Davis has pledged to set up a working group between his department and the combined authorities, and he'll also be coming to meet with myself and the city region leaders to hear directly about our priorities during the Brexit negotiations. Yesterday I spoke at the city region's digital summit, and I need to thank both Steve Hammond, Mark Basnett, and especially John Whaling, who pulled together a fantastic event which brought together over 120 experts and businesses to promote the region's digital offer and to discuss how we can develop a world-leading digital infrastructure. As part of this, I became the first ever Metro Mayor to take part in a transatlantic virtual reality interview with a guy called Professor Terry Dubois, who is also a Stanford University professor, and he worked for NASA. But we spoke in the virtual world, face to face, if you like, on issues around digital connectivity and how he believes that Liverpool and our city region are really starting to take this new technology forward. I think Wednesday I attended NIPU UK, which is in London at the Olympia, to promote the city region as one of the leading places for investment in the whole UK, showcasing our major future investments and transformational infrastructure plans. Whilst I was there, I had numerous meetings with potential investors. People literally are queuing up now to talk to us in our area. And I took part in a joint event with Manchester to promote the North West. I'm also, in the next week or so, scheduled to attend a meeting with Greg Clark, Secretary of State for Business, Energy and Industrial Strategy, at the end of this month, to discuss unlocking further investment to develop the city region's economy. Talking about the city region economy, the Mersey Gateway Bridge, one of the largest infrastructure projects outside of London, was formally opened on the 14th of October, and my office has received a large amount of correspondence in relation to the bridge, which I will be responding to. And just yesterday, we received more good news. I'm pleased to announce that we have received £5.6 million from the NPIF, which I've wrote down here, which is the National Productivity Investment Fund. And that is for two schemes, the A59, which you know very well, which is the Walton and County Road area, and the A554, which is Tower Road in Wirral, that Phil will know. But it's to improve roads, cut congestion, and improve journey times. So more views from the fact that we do have a devolution deal and a city region Metro Met. I'll leave it there, but there are lots of other things that have happened, and it has to be said that the sheer volume of institutional organisations, global wealth funds, etc., who are now making or beating their path to the city region really shows that we can make huge game-changing and transformational projects in our city happen. We obviously just need now to ensure, and I'll close this off, we need to ensure that the structures are right, which we are well on the way to fully develop. So item 5 is the local growth fund approval of the full major business case, and it's the Liverpool City Centre connectivity scheme, which is commenced on the 2018-19. The scheme aims to reduce traffic on key streets, provide improved pedestrian and cycle facilities, and support the new bus routing strategy for the city centre. Frank Rogers is going to take us through this report.
Thanks, Chair. As has been referenced there, the purpose of this report is to look for approval of the Transport Advisory Group's recommendation to the CA for approval of the full business case for the Liverpool City Centre connectivity scheme. perhaps best calling it phase one at this stage, given another item that we'll be touching on later. This is actually the last of our LGF1 projects to come forward for combined authority approval. So it's quite a milestone for the CA now to say that we are in a position where, subject to the decision of today's combined authority, we may take all of our schemes through the process and into delivery phase. It's a scheme that has a total of 38.4 million made available to the city region for this connectivity programme. It's a scheme being delivered by Liverpool City Council, and it's looking at, as Metro Mayor has advised there, proposals to improve connectivity in Liverpool City Centre, make the city more attractive and easier to travel around, and to look at dominance of the vehicle on some of our key streets. We do have Andy Barr, who is the Highways Manager for Liverpool City Council here, who's able to answer any of the detailed questions that may arise as a consequence of the consideration of the report. The detail is there in the document, as is the report that came in from the independent advisory body, Watermans, who we've employed as a CA to do the assessments of schemes of this nature. Watermans are satisfied with the project, and so based on the advice of them as our independent assessors, Transport Advisory Group recommends that the CA approve the major scheme business case for Liverpool City Centre connectivity and enable Liverpool City Council as the promoter to draw down then on the funding to grant the delivery of the project and look to support the ambitions of the Liverpool City region. As I mentioned, I'm more than happy to take questions, as is Andy Barr from Liverpool City Council. Thank you.
Any questions from members? Can we agree the recommendation therefore set out on page 15? So what happens now, we've approved the scheme in principle, but in light of the concerns that have been expressed as outlined on paragraph 4.7, can I suggest that we continue the dialogue as set out in that report? Is that agreed? Item 6 is the Palmal Exchange Site and the City Centre Phase 2 for business case, both seeking approval for funds and single investment funds, and both applications are supported by a full business case and the aim of the Internal Dedicated Services to take us through this report.
Thank you, Chair. This is an investment fund funded from our single investment fund. It's a two projects. It's for the Palmal project, for an award of some of 3.5 million, and it's for City Centre Connectivity Phase 2 in the sum of 18.6 million. Again, it links to the earlier report that it's critical that the schemes are considered as an overarching package rather than discrete schemes that don't interface with each other. We called four applications into the SIP, 46 projects were received for approval to development of a strategic outline case for those particular projects. These two schemes now have gone through that particular process. They've gone through the outline business case approval, and what we're looking for now is for CA approval of these two projects at full business case. There is detail on each of the schemes attached to Appendix 1 and Appendix 2, and again, more than happy to answer any questions that members of the final authority may have in respect of those two schemes.
Are there any questions? Can we agree the recommendations are set out on page 29? Item 7 is a portfolio update, and Ian Main is going to run us through the skills and apprenticeship portfolio we received with a very snappy red tie. Today is show racing in the red car with Red Day, and there's a veritable feast of red around the room. No better display than Councillor May.
Thanks, Steve. I just wanted to show you where my skills and apprenticeship portfolio. What is it? Where are we? Lots of stuff going on within this. And if we just recap on where we're going and what the deal was and what you think, and this first slide, we're looking at implementing the devolution agreement, and that includes overseeing devolution of the adult education budget, which we'll touch on a bit later, co-design back to work support, if we need to improve apprenticeships, careers hub, strategic commissioning, because the capital of 41 projects with over £30 million committed, ESF funds by the ESIF committee, we've got 56 million and 22 projects going forward on that. Strategic delivery is what it says there, 5.9 million youth employment gateway, 4 million skills for growth, 4.6 household in the way programme. And we have, of course, input and discussions and information from our Employment Skills Board, which works hard alongside us in helping us understand and deliver that. The Skills Commission, just taking stock of what we're doing within the region, taking stock of where we think we might need to go with our skills agenda in the coming years, and have a independent review of what we should be doing. And of course we've also had, I'm just come to the end of, the employee skills survey, biggest we've ever done, but almost 2,000 businesses approached and spoke to, things taken into consideration. And that, Mr. Mayor, will feed into what the Skills Commission look forward to, what to deliver, what to advise us on. So that's a really important part of where we are within the portfolio. Got some influence on the training provision. The area-based review of our colleges has come to a conclusion. We were the first, I think, for a city region to have an involvement. And normally it's been an education system that just works with the bureaucrats from London on the way forward for colleges within the region. And as part of our deal, I chaired that process for the first time ever, or usually it's chaired by an official from from Westminster. That was a fairly long process. It had some good discussions, I think is a fair way of doing it, fair way of saying that. And we move forward now, and we are moving forward, we've gone into the implementation stage of that, which is securing the futures of the colleges, very, very important thing for our region. We've got skills for growth, we've got devolution of the education budget. Now, there's delays on that within government's timetable. It's supposed to come for next year, for the coming year. Through no fault or reason of our own, that is now delayed for a fair year, but we are looking to agree that we have influence on the coming year, or influence on what they deliver, and we will pick that up the following year and work with our providers to make sure that everything else that we've done to feed into what skills are needed within the region going forward is led forward by us and by that. Devolving down with that funding. Chair, if we move on to the Youth Employment Gateway, well, that's been a pretty good success, I think. There's almost £6 million quid of mentoring going on. There's my budget for young people for £500. And that's for them to spend on what they think will help them get into work. We had an app designed and to help them manage the budget plan. Very well taken from our young people, very well received. And since October 2014, almost 5,000 young people have received support. And 2,077, 42% of them have actually found work. Which is good, but it's a new principles. Skills for growth, again. Slide in front of us, Chair, some good figures there. 462 employers across the city region accessed it. 4,346 learners have been supported. We roll on with that because again, it's needed. There's a lot going on within this particular portfolio, a lot going on, and it's really important stuff. The skill shows, we've done 20 skill shows, but we've both done by June 18, 18 local ones, 2 large city region ones, on the supporting schools approach, career plan, the careers hub. Now that's an important thing as well, that we get more leadership from within our schools on technological way forward, on helping young people at an early age understand or look forward to what they go forward, how they go forward into the world of work and employment. I don't think it's not news to anybody who knows. I don't think that we within this country spend enough time within our education system in helping young people get ready, not just for an academic route, which is absolutely spot on to go toward an academic route, going to university, and all of those, but run alongside that. For those that don't wish to go down a particular route, more support needs to be done in that way to help people make the choices when they need to make those choices. So again, that's a really important thing. We go on to the work programme that we have going in front of us in the next 12 months. That day in front of us, there's lots to be carried on and lots to be delivered, and we'll do that. And just finally, just again coming up in the next few months, we've got the skills investment statement. Which is short-term priority for local colleges to respond to. We've got our skills strategy by Christmas. This is a longer-term objective, no longer the wider strategic skills context. And just leading back to what I said a few moments ago, the Institute of Technology. Governments have called for proposals on the Institute of Technology, and we'll certainly be looking at that and looking at whether we put and when, how, what, where we put that forward or not, once we've looked into the details of what that means. And of course, the area based review, we've got the implementation going on, we've got you practically ready, and we need to be ready also for the devolution of the adult skills budget when it finally comes, when we get the finger out. I'll finish there, Chair.
Thanks. Any questions or Phil's already?
Yeah, can I thank Ian for that presentation? I think it's helpful. Can I say I welcome the establishment of the Skills Commission, because I think that's addressing some of the fundamental questions that we've grappled with in this community for a long time now. You know, questions like what is our route map forward on skills? What are we trying to achieve? And critically, how can we ensure that our residents in this region have the skills to take advantage of the job opportunities going forward in the future. So I do welcome that. The other point I wanted to raise, Chair, I know Ian, you're aware of this because we've talked about it previously, is the apprenticeship levy, and the way I think that is working in a very perverse way. The rules that the government set down mean that you can't use that apprenticeship levy, the funds from that, to employ people. You can't use it for salaries. So for those big organisations, I include local authorities in that, that have to pay the levy, there's plenty of money to upskill existing staff, but no money at all to take on new staff, particularly, for example, people coming out of the education system, school leavers. And I just think government are really missing the trick by being so restrictive and not allowing any of the apprenticeship levy monies to be used for salaries. I know this is a big issue in the private sector as well, because I've spoken to a number of companies in my area who are expressing frustration about the restrictive way in which the levy rules are operating. So I think, Chair, I think we agree that you were right on our behalf to government, asking them to be more flexible in the way that we're allowed to use the income from the levy. Thank you.
I think Phil has asked me some questions and answered them for me. So,
the rhetorical question.
The rhetorical question, yes. Yeah. Well, I totally agree with what you said, particularly with the apprenticeship revenue. It doesn't make sense at some levels.
Any further questions to Council Mayor? Thank Council Mayor on behalf of everybody for the work that he's done. If we're getting our skills strategy right, it's absolutely vital to future economic growth. I was interested in that mention, personal advisors, personalised budgets, expertise out of that. I do think that we need to be more at an early stage. And one of those routes for us should be the ability to influence the residual underspend of the apprenticeship levy. Council Davis is quite rightly highlighting, and we'll be writing to the Secretary of State, and we'll pursue this one as vigorously as we possibly can, because it's the right thing for our city region. Can we note the presentation? Eight is the next report seeking approval to commission activity from the Local Growth Fund 3 award, and this is support limited round of projects to improve quality and resilience of the city region's most important roads. And again, can I ask the Chair Service to talk us through the report?
Thank you, Chair. It's perhaps helpful that Councillor O'Byrne isn't here for this particular report, because this has got SIF, LGF1, LGF3, KRN, there's a whole raft of acronyms within this particular report that we referred to. What we're looking through this process is to gain authority from the combined authority to commission up to £25 million worth of the £72 million that's been allocated to the city region for LGF3 funding. It's available between 2017-18 and 2020-21, and the scope of the commission is set out in Appendix 1 to the report. The report is also looking for derogation from the combined authorities' adopted assurance framework that governs the use of these funds, and this is with the aim of looking to shorten the application process from three stages down to two, in order to support the underlying aims of the report, and to try and seek to commit a significant element of funding before the end of the 17-18 financial year. We have a request from government to move some of the funding earlier on into the programme, into 17-18, and what we're looking to do here through the process is to try and commit to a series of schemes that enables us to look at more front-loading of the particular programme involved. So, back in July of 2016, the Combined Authority submitted a bid for the third round of LGF monies. We were subsequently awarded £71.95 million as a consequence of that bid, and the intent is to look to support growth in our city region through investment in transport, skills and business and innovation. The amount awarded to Liverpool City Region was the second highest sum on a national basis, and the table at 3.3 there gives a split of the allocation of those sums of money. £40 million went to transport as a notional allocation, of which the Key Route Network, or the KRN, would pick up £25 million. Rail enhancements particularly targeted and leaving some of the congestion pressures and capacity issues at Liverpool Central Station, allocated £5 million, and a multimodal package looking at support and access to housing and employment sites, another £10 million. Just shy of £24 million was allocated for business innovation, and £8 million for skills, bringing us up to the just shy of £72 million in total. The profile for the funding is scheduled at 3.4, and as mentioned earlier, £16.7 million of that is for 17-18. It's expected that the ability for us to deliver spending in 17-18 is going to be limited as a consequence of time frame, but what we are looking to do is to commission the schemes in 17-18 to demonstrate that the process is ongoing and we are pressing ahead with it. So following a review that we've undertaken at the City Region's pipeline of the projects, it has been identified that there are interventions available to us to enhance our key route network. The key route network was specifically included in the Local Growth Fund 3 bid. It's an element of our devolution agreement with government. It's a key priority from a mayoral perspective, and is part of the devolution deal, as I touched on, and has got an extensive focus of interest from government. For
4.5 there details the areas around which we're looking to focus the investment in the key route network around, and 4.6 again touches on the 25 million that we're looking to commission should this report be approved, and the 16.76 million associated with financial year 17-18. So in conclusion, the authority has been successful at securing 72 million, 16.7 million is available to us this year. It's proposed that the combined authority commission, core focused on the key route network or KRN, and that key route network core is capped at 25 million. That will give us the facility to support improved access across the streets and main employment growth sites, and the commission would then work to generate projects that improve the quality and the resilience of the city region's key highway assets, and focused on those routes that do link, open up, or enhance the city region's main economic growth zones. As I touched on earlier, the report also seeks approval to vary some of the provisions that have the CA's adopted assurance framework to ensure that we are able to use these funds in an efficient and effective way to support the above aims and to enable commitment of funding before the end of the current financial year. I'm happy to take any questions that there may be in relation to the report.
Are there any comments or questions on the report? If not, can we agree the recommendations set out on pages 41 and 42?
Agreed.
Now, Councillor Davis is going to take us through this report, which sets out the arrangements for discharge and the combined authority's duties as an intermediate body in respect of the European Structural and Investment Funds Programme.
Thanks, Steve. So, as you say, this report sets out how we plan to manage and discharge this intermediate body powers that we gained as a result of the devolution deal in respect of European structural funding. In essence, we've got now a much stronger role over the way in which structural funds that cover the city region are allocated and shaped. In two key respects. First of all, we're more able to ensure that any bids that come forward have a strong strategic fit with our priorities and policies. And secondly, we're going to have a stronger role when it comes to drafting calls for projects coming forward. So I think that's welcome news. I think the report also, just to highlight, proposes a short assurance framework in Appendix 2 that's very similar to the one that we've introduced for our single investment funds, and that sets out clearly how we're going to discharge our duties in practice, and I think is transparent in the way the governance will work. So we're recommending, Chair, that delegations to lead officers and members will be the most efficient and practical way of doing what we need to do when applications come in. Usually at very short turnaround deadlines, so I think that will be helpful. And then finally, the report also addresses representation issues from the authority on our local European Structural Funding Committee. So in essence, that's basically what this report is seeking to do. I'm happy to answer any questions. Otherwise, I'm happy to recommend the recommendations. Thank you.
Are there any comments or questions, Councillor Mayor?
Yes, Chair, with regards to recommendation D, highlighting the Council Eddie Johnson Halton, who is portfolio holder and a member of the Employment Skills Committee.
Can we agree the recommendations set out on page 51 and 52 of the report, first? And can I ask the question, Council Mayor, to nominate from the Employer and Skills Board to the ESIF committee, the nominee of Eddie Jones from Halton. Is that agreed?
Agreed.
Item 10 is the proposed change to the constitution, and the item is about proposing amendments to the deadline, specifically of public question time and statements of petitions. And Jill Keel is going to take us through this report.
Scope for self-explanatory. It practically changes the deadline for both public questions and statements and petitions.
Item 11 is public questions at the time. We'll receive two questions from the Women's Leadership Group. And I invite Fiona Armstrong Gibbs to ask the two questions. And Fiona, if you want to do them sequentially,
yeah.
And then we'll answer at the end. Thank you.
Thank you. Considering the sectors highlighted in our questions below, employ between 2 and 12% of women, how does the recent round of SIF funding of approximately £76 million, reported at the last meeting on the 15th of September, benefit women and black and minority ethnic people employed in those projects and those sectors? And the second one, at the last meeting on the 15th of September, it was highlighted in the Liverpool City Region Employer Skills Survey that low-skilled jobs and employers who create these low-skilled and low-paid jobs is a concern for the LCRCA, and one that we also share. How will you ensure the plan you develop to challenge this is open, transparent, and with no conflict of interests?
Okay, thank you for both questions, Fiona. We will ensure that we write to you as we normally do, and then, of course, the business responds with a written response within 10 working days. Thank you. 10 is petitions and statements, which we've received not within the deadline. And 13 is the Minutes of the Transport Committee. Unfortunately, Councillor Ian Robinson is not able to be here. He's at a meeting with the DMT at the Mersey Gateway. Can we agree the minutes? Are there any questions on the minutes?
It's just down to Deputy Chair.
Ah, apologies. Okay. Well, welcome. Are there, can you confirm the minutes set out on 85 and 96, please?
Agreed.
Agreed. That's agreed. We've not been informed of any urgent items, so the next meeting of the Planning Authority will take place on Friday the 17th of November 2017 at 1 o'clock as usual here in the Authority Chamber. I declare the meeting closed.